Hello, everyone. My name is Yong Lee, Deputy Director of the Korea Program at APARC, and I welcome everyone to the Korea Program's first seminar this quarter. As you may know, the Korean National Assembly voted to impeach President Park Geun-hye, and her case is now under consideration at the Constitutional Court. While it's not yet clear whether she will be impeached, the nation has experienced political turmoil for the last several months. In this regard, we have a very timely event. It's titled Impeachment and After, What Does the Future Hold for Korea's Politics? Our very own Professor Yumi Moon from the History Department has agreed to introduce and moderate today's panel.
Thank you for the introduction. I'm Yumi Moon in the History Department. I have been looking forward to this panel, and I've been watching Korea's situation in newspapers with concerns, but it's been difficult to understand what is going on really in Korea. And personally, the recent arrest of Minister of Sports and Culture, Cho Yoon-sun, is a shock to me. I know her, and she and I were from the same high school and same university, same department. She's really smart and decent in personal relations, and but perhaps hardly go against authority figures. Her success, it is my personal statement, but so I want to be honest, you know, because this is a serious
issue.
Record. Yeah, on the record, but reporters, please, you know, take care of me. But her success in Park's administration indicates the president's leadership style. At the same time, it's very disappointing that Minister Cho did not make an ethical choice as a lawyer after watching the existence of blacklist against progressive writers, artists, and performers. I think South Korean, I'm very sympathetic to South Korean conservatives, but South Korean conservatives now show their most incompetent faces, I think. So I hope that they will make serious efforts to reform themselves. This is my beginning statement, and today our the presenter, Dr. Ji-young Kang. Dr. Ji-young Kang is Assistant Professor of Communication Studies and Korean Studies at the University of Iowa, and her research interests include South Korean social movements, internet activism, youth culture, and globalization. And her recent book, Igniting the Internet, Youth and Activism in Post-Authoritarian South Korea, examines a decade of internet activism in South Korea. She combined textual analysis of online communities with ethnographic interviews. She had many articles, and they appeared in Communication and Critical Cultural Studies, Journal of Broadcasting Electronic Media, Quarterly Journal of Speech Communication, Journal of Korean Studies, and Global Networks. Heather said that I have to introduce Ki-hyuk Shin and Kathleen Stevens, Ambassador Kathleen, very shortly. So please, you know, Professor Ki-hyuk Shin is the director of the Walter H. Shorstein Asia Pacific Research Center. She is the Dongyang Korea Foundation and Korea Stanford Alumni Chair of Korean Studies. She is the founder of Korean Studies program at Stanford, and now professor in sociology at Stanford. And Ambassador Kathleen Stevens, she's the former U.S. ambassador to the Republic of Korea. She was one of the most beloved ambassadors in Seoul. And she is now currently the William J. Perry Fellow in the Korea program at Walter Shorstein Asia Pacific Research Center. Thank you, and please, Dr. Kang.
Thank you for the introduction. And then it is my honor to be on the same panel with the three esteemed experts of South Korean history and politics. And as someone who studies South Korean internet politics and social movements, I follow the scandals surrounding Park with shock and sometimes fascination, even though the pace of it was sometimes very dizzying. As the first speaker of this panel, and I was given about 20 minutes, And I'll briefly overview major events leading to the impeachment and then share three reflections on the temporary reflections on the cause and the nature of the nationwide protest. So, and this is my title. So the brief timeline of what happened in October last year. So a scandal arose about the influence of Choi Soon-sil, the daughter of a cult leader, over President Park. Several news media reported that Choi had access to classified documents and even edited Park's important speeches and foreign policy and the North-South Korea relationships. Park publicly acknowledged her close ties with Choi, but denied Choi's influence on her work as president. However, other sensational details were released, including that Samsung funded Choi's daughter, who's on the national equestrian team, and then Choi's influence enabled the daughter to enter prestigious Ewha University, and that Choi and her close friends handpicked high-ranked government officials, and then Choi sought funds from several conglomerates or chaebol, including Samsung, Hyundai, and SK. And then around the time, Park's approval rating fell to merely 5%. Organized online, the first Canline protest erupted on October 29th and was held in downtown Seoul. After this, the Canline protest became a weekly event. And then this photo is a group of protesters dressed as Choi Soon-sil, the president, Park Geun-hye, and then equestrian, the daughter of Choi Soon-sil. And protests continued in November. More than 1 million citizens participated in the protest downtown, close to the presidential residence for the first time in history. And the focus was originally on Choi, who was called by some Korea's Rasputin, but gradually the focus shifted to Park, who the public believed abused power, pressured chaebol to support Choi's private foundations, and neglected her duty as president. So on November 29th, Park offered to resign as president in a televised address. This is an image from that address. She said she will, quote, "let the National Assembly decide when I should step down to ensure an orderly transfer of power." I'm quoting this because it is later met by public outrage and a parody. And opposition parties rejected the offer, accusing Park of attempting to avoid an impeachment. Until then, in fact, the oppositional parties were reluctant to pursue impeachments because they were far from the two-thirds majority, or 200 votes, in the National Assembly required to impeach the president. However, on the following Saturday, on December 3rd, over 2 million participants showed up at the protest, which is about 2.5% of entire country's population. According to a poll this weekend, 78% of Koreans supported her impeachment. That day, 171 members of the three oppositional parties initiated the impeachment proposal. And December 9th, the National Assembly voted overwhelmingly to impeach Park, and at least 63 members of the governing Saenuri Party also voted in favor of impeachment. And as already mentioned, currently the Constitutional Party is in the process of deliberating the impeachment motion. Here are some questions. Corruption scandals are not new to Korean politics, and we just discussed that right before this panel. And especially toward the end of a president's tenure, Koreans are familiar with those kind of scandals. But how did this particular scandal induce such intense national opposition? And how did citizens, including teenagers and families, become initiators of the impeachment while oppositional parties were reluctant to pursue it? And finally, what does this such internet-born mass protest mean for South Korea's popular politics? I want to share just my three analyses, one concerning Park herself, and the other one concerning South Korea's recent popular politics and then public perceptions. And eventually, I'll argue, like my title, that Park's political scandal and then her responses to them were considered, quote-unquote, an insult or moyok to the Korean people. Well, in the public mind, Park became an anachronistic leader who was fundamentally authoritarian in her approach and unfit for a democratic Korea that they envision as their country. So finally, I'll briefly talk about the changing valence or the meaning of democracy as observed in the protest. So the first part is Park's contested legitimacy and the bifurcated public around her. So I'm sure that many of you are somewhat familiar with her personal background, but Park debuted on the national political scene in 1998 by winning a National Assembly election. As a leader of the Conservative Party, she commanded undefeated popularity among the older generation and voters in Gyeongsang province who had nostalgia for her father, president or dictator Park Jong-hee, who was the president from 1960 to 1978. She was also a very emotionally charged figure in Korean politics. After her mother was assassinated in 1974, Park became an acting first lady at age 22 and served that role until her father's assassination in 1979. So even my parents have some sympathy toward her because same generation, lost both of the parents very tragically. So when she came back to the political scene and then led Saenuri Party to a number of victories in general elections, she was hailed as having her father's leadership and then bringing all the nostalgia. However, because of the same reasons, she stood for the status quo and evoked the memories of the authoritarian rule. Especially among culturally liberal younger population, Park was an unpopular president from the beginning. I think that I need to mention her predecessor, Lee Myung-bak, also from the same Conservative Party, who was president from 2008 to 2013. So her predecessor, Lee Myung-bak, younger voters, in fact, had a hope that the CEO president, the former CEO of Hyundai, would boost the economy. However, they largely withdrew their hope by 2012 with the growing class disparity and then youth unemployment rates, along with decreasing opportunities. There was a strong desire by 2012 among younger people to elect a candidate from the oppositional party. So this 2012 exit poll shows the generational differences or generational breakdown of the votes. So as you can see, Park received predominant support from those who are in their 50s or over the side, while those who experienced the Korean War and the industrialization under the Park Jong-hee regime. In contrast, voters in their 20s and 30s predominantly supported Moon from the Liberal Democratic Party. Additionally, political scandals and controversies further undermined her legitimacy. For instance, it was found that a team of South Korean intelligence agents carried out an online smear campaign against Moon during the presidential election. 2014, while Koreans were watching live as Sewol Ferry was sinking and killing about 300 passengers, mostly high school students, Park was largely absent for the first 7 hours. There were some rumors about her whereabouts, but instead of explaining where she was, Park sued journalists for reporting allegations. And then in 2015, the MERS outbreak killed 38 people, and then it also sparked anger at the government for hiding information and failing to control its spread. And the same year, the government pursued a state-issued history textbook that many people expected to gloss over the legacies of the country's conservative elites, including Park's father. So with these controversies, a sizable portion of the population was ready to voice their grievances and question Park's leadership even before the scandal erupted. And in fact, many of those issues were later brought up during the impeachment protests. Second, on the side of the popular politics, the internet-born street protest was being established as a new movement repertoire. I'm sure that many people in this room would be familiar with this format of internet-born candlelight vigils that started with the 2002 World Cup. That was the first time that the downtown Seoul was open to the crowd. And then 2002, we have seen the first candlelight vigils in commemoration of two girls killed by a U.S. military vehicle. And then in 2008, we have also seen very festive protests by teenagers against beef imports, despite the concern about the mad cow disease. So tech-savvy teenagers use the format of internet-born candlelight vigils for various other reasons, not just those famous ones, but high school students also organize candlelight vigils against high school hair regulations and then some educational policies. So, of course, there are some radical activists, and of course, there are some elements of anti-Americanism in some of those protests. However, I believe that these are new repertoires of activism, characterized by online mobilization, casual participation, and then format of peaceful and then festive crowd, which was replacing the old repertoire that were ideologically charged and often violent, the kind of protest that you cannot participate without a prior commitment. So, and then furthermore, parody and subversion were always found on the internet. However, over time, protesters enacted them in the street, using the protest as a space for festival, irreverent parody, and the performances has become a familiar trope that Koreans found. So, again in 2016, Koreans used parodies online and in the streets, developing their collective understanding of the matter. In this particular one, Choi is playing the popular game of Princess Maker, while Park was a mere character living in the shadow of her father and controlled by Choi. And similar kinds of parodies are also found in the streets. Park is a mere avatar controlled by Choi, who's debating. And while Choi is debating whether to close the Kaesong industrial complex, between North and South Korea, and how to dress her. So I think that those capture the public sentiment. So while political parties were deciding how to proceed with this area of scandals, protesters were quickly defining that Park was violating the constitution that stipulates that South Korea is a democracy. And these capture the public response to Park's statement that I showed you earlier. So when Park offered to step down in an orderly manner, many felt that this is a political game, a smart political move. However, a political game to delay the process by dividing the public and appealing to national security. Instant resignation became a slogan for the candlelight protest immediately after Park's press conference, or something like this went viral. And along with it, the sense of national shame and embarrassment were recurring themes in the popular responses, such as, is this a country? So here, Park became a kind of emblem of anachronistic leader who was somewhat authoritarian in her approach and tried to persuade or even worse, manipulate people with outdated strategies of appealing to national security or patriotism. And additionally, the protesters brought up the issues that Park suppressed, like Seoul ferry sinking, and those that she pursued despite wide criticism, such as the state-issued history textbook. So those are the brief overview of what happened and then how it proceeds. And finally, a few implications for South Korea's protest and the popular politics, I'm sure, even though Professor Shin is an expert here. But I agree with some scholars and critics who argue that the nostalgia and the legacies attached to Park Jung-hee are finally collapsing, or the beginning to collapse, after almost 40 years after his death. And then furthermore, this could indicate a shift in the political culture. 1987 democratization achieved institutional democracy. However, since then, culturally, Korean politics consolidated largely two-party system centering around charismatic leadership. Some of them were formal presence, and then clear regional basis and differing approaches to North Korea and the US. So this shows that institutional democracy is not enough as democratic politics. And then here I found Manuel Castells, a communication scholar, somewhat relevant. He proposed or even predicted that in the media-saturated environment, scandal politics will become ordinary part of politics. every nook and cranny of power becomes a potential target for public exposure. And once information is released, it's nearly impossible to control the virus spread of news. And any established power is subject to continual challenge to its democracy. So, two final thoughts. So, I don't think that internet produce informed critical citizens, but this scandal politics becomes a new mode of popular politics, and it can quickly turn users into an attentive and then critical public at a given juncture. And as the impeachment suggests, this popular politics is defined not only by established procedures and agendas, but by the new forms that has potential to exceed the bounds of existing institutional boundaries and rules, like South Korean protest pushed the impeachment as an agenda while politicians were still concerned or reluctant. And the internet-born candlelight protest has become a kind of predictable response to a controversial issue after 15 years of being practiced. And through it, citizens question the operation of the government and authority and then demand transparency. So I think that transparency will become recurrent question in any political culture and in political parties in the future. Thank you.
Gian already covered some issues that I was going to cover, but I'm going to maybe bring up some topics for further discussions. And in a personal note, I hosted President Park Geun-hye in 2009 to Stanford, actually. So, and at the time, who knew that I will be discussing about her impeachment, 8 years later. But it's a really sad story and really disappointing for many of us, because a lot of people expected her to be quite different than other presidents of Korea, especially a lot of people expected her to be at least very clean in politics, but actually what's happening is quite a tragic story. I think what we have seen over the last several months is a fairly familiar pattern of social and political change in Korean history. We know that Korea has had a very strong state. Korean presidency is very powerful. But at the same time, Korean society or people, they were never, passive or, inactive. They were highly contentious against state and strong state power. So this, pattern of, strong state and contentious society has shaped Korean social and political changes over the last many decades. I mean, we can go back to 1987, 1980, and 1960, and so on. And as Gian, points out, in this case also, political parties or politicians, they followed civic activism rather than they led. So initially, politicians were very hesitant to demand impeachment of President Park Geun-hye, but only after popular demand became quite strong and clear, then they joined this call for impeachment. The second one, I think what happened in the protest, in my view, it's an explosion of popular discontent. I happened to be in Korea in November, so I actually went to see candlelight protest in November 12th, which was very large. And actually, I happened to be in 1987 and also 1980, of course, in Korea. And I think, really people from diverse backgrounds came to join the protest. And probably they may have had, different reasons, maybe reflecting growing inequality, youth unemployment, even elderly poverty, I think discontent with very authoritarian style of governance by the Park Geun-hye government, and also maybe overall fatigue of 10-year conservative rule. So if you remember the last days of Nguyen in a government, actually, he was also very unpopular. But anyways, a combination of those factors led to mobilization of these people for protest. And also, it shows limitation of the current political power structure in Korea. As Jin also said, corruption and political scandals are really nothing new in Korea's recent history. I mean, if you remember, Kim Young-sam, his son got into jail, right, when Kim Young-sam was still in office. And for Kim Dae-jung, two sons went into jail. For Nguyen, his elder brother, same for Lee Myung-bak. So unfortunately, in the past maybe 20 years or so, family members of Korean president got into trouble, and then they actually had to serve in the prison. So I think this really raises an important question that hopefully we can maybe discuss and debate in Q&A. Looks like Park Geun-hye did something wrong. I mean, I don't think I can deny that. I think the main question is, were those wrongdoings bad enough to impeach her? I think this is the most crucial question that we have to address. So in other words, if this happened 20 years ago in Korea, I mean, would you expect the same thing of impeachment of a president? So according to Korean constitution, presidents can be impeached if she or he makes a grave violation of constitutional law. And I think it's a fairly general guideline. So in my view, there are two dimensions of impeachment process. Okay, one is political dimension, the other one legal dimension or legal judgment. I think politically she was already impeached, right? I mean, the assembly voted to impeach her, by big margin. But then legally, I think still it's a question, because still legal deliberation is underway, and nothing has been proven to be guilty. So I think when I was in Korea last November, I talked to some Western journalists. Okay, they were having a hard time to understand Korean situation, because they are saying that still she hasn't proven to be guilty, and then how you can impeach her. I mean, that was kind of main question that I heard from Western correspondent in Korea. I mean, that's why I wrote with Renny Moon this article that you saw, she lost mandate of heaven, because I was trying to explain in terms of Korean political culture. So legally, maybe it's not decided, but still she lost mandate of heaven as a legitimate leader for Korean society. So, but at the same time, there might be possible tension between political and legal dimensions. Okay, what if? Okay, I'm just raising question. What if legally she is all right, right? But politically, she's impeached. So I think, in a sense, there are, I think, good and bad, a dimension of this situation. The positive one is, certainly, Korean democracy has progressed. Once again, if this happened 20 years ago, I think he or she was all right. But now, not anymore. That means that certainly, Korea became much more tougher on political scandal. I think that's a good sign. But on the other hand, I'm a little concerned that this activism-driven political change, because let's say like 3 or 4 years later, what if people became also very unhappy and then demanding impeachment of new president? I mean, it's not impossible to imagine the scenario. Okay, so finally then what will happen? As you know, there are three simultaneous deliberation. One at the court, the other one investigation by a special prosecutor, and then the last one, deliberation at the constitutional court. So I'm sure you'd like to, you know, ask whether she will be impeached or not, right? So I think most people in Korea assume that she will be, and I have to agree. But I think my own view, still there's a small chance that she may not be impeached. Okay, I'd say maybe 90% chance of impeachment and maybe 10% of not. And if yes, then Korea will hold election for a new president within 30 days of the verdict. That means that probably Korea will have election maybe sometime like May, I guess. But even though the chance is very low, but what if she survives? I think then Korea will really get into political turmoil and instability, and then it's very hard to predict what's going to happen. So hopefully I provoked enough your thoughts that we can maybe have some discussion, debate, and Q&A. Thank you.
In fact, we had a heated debate, before you came to this panel. So I think because this so-called scare politics is so hot, so I think Professor Shin raised some kind of questions. At the same time, the things to think about, because legal procedures is still very important in making this final decision. So next speaker is Ambassador Stephens on foreign relations.
Okay. Thank you, Yumi. My assigned task here is to talk a little bit about how this ongoing political crisis is affecting Korea's foreign relations, perhaps particularly with the United States. I think my other task is to not stand in the way of what I think will be a very lively discussion. But I can't, since you've given me the microphone, I can't stop myself from saying something really about my own, I guess, more personal observations of what we're seeing unfold in Korea. And I say this in the context of someone who first lived in Korea when Park Geun-hye was the acting first lady, right after her mother had been assassinated. So I am of that generation myself, although not Korean, who remembers this rather iconic young woman and her dignity. I have to say, when I went back to Korea many, many years later, I was astonished, but it says a lot about many things in Korea, that she was in politics and running for president. But even more, what I saw in my years in Korea, and I was there in the 1980s for 6 years as following Korean politics from the American embassy, when issues like democratization, human rights were issues we talked about in South Korea, not North Korea. And someone like my friend Dan Snyder, who saw a lot of demonstrations, a lot of really impressive demonstrations, mostly broken up with lots and lots of tear gas and rocks and arrests, maybe I just provide that context to say when I see a VML video with music by Coldplay with these demonstrations, and I saw the one on November 12th as well, which are really extraordinary, and they're kind of festivals in a way too. I think there's lots of sociological study to be done about that, but they're almost in a way part of, I would even say, depending on how this comes out, South Korea's soft power. I mean, we saw a lot of big crowds, huge crowds here in the United States on Saturday and Sunday, but it's hard to beat a South Korean crowd, not just for size or for percentage of the population out there, but for the, shall I say, the creativity and the peacefulness and the order with which people are expressing their views. Even as someone who's spent a lot of time and watched Korea's democratic journey over the years, even as someone like that, I'm still a foreigner there, and I also, like your journalist, Western journalist friends, found myself kind of scratching my head a little bit last November when I was back there. Because remember, Pakane was coming, is coming, to the end of a one-term, five-year presidency. The normally scheduled election in Korea is December. So she's, you know, already and was, you know, yeah. She already was a lame duck. And like, as Professor Shin mentioned, I mean, I think like every Korean president, rather sadly, as they approach the end of their five-year term, and actually even before that, when they didn't have any discernible, you know, intention or means of stepping down, a la perhaps Syngman Rhee, things ended badly. And that last year was a long downhill slide. Now, this has happened faster for Park Geun-hye, and we've kind of alluded to some of those reasons. But for an outsider, it's a little puzzling. You know, I said to people who were out there on the streets, I mean, you're having an election in December, you know. Aren't you paying attention to, like, who's going to be next? What's the difference going to be? It may be a difference of not at all, if indeed the court does not uphold the National Assembly's decision to impeach her. You may end up right where you started, except worse, maybe. Or you may end up with an election just a month or 2 months, or at most maybe about 6 months earlier than you would have anyway. Kind of what's the difference? But I recognize, and also from and what, you know, what is the case here, and what's the legal, you know, isn't there a process to go through? And although we're both democracies and proud of our democracy, I think it was kind of a cultural difference mm-hmm. there. And it was very much, and you alluded to, well, in your remarks and in your title, Koreans said to me, we're so embarrassed. I'm not sure that's the right way, Cheng-pyeo, right? Mm-hmm. We're so embarrassed that this is our president. And, you know, I kind of said, well, there's a lot I'm embarrassed about in American politics, too. We won't go into that now. But, you know, it's not the first thing I would say and saying, no, I mean, I'm kind of serious, you know. But there's this sense of a mandate of heaven and that we can't wait for our institutions whether to make this right, that we have a responsibility as citizens. And I think this is based in a certain kind of political culture that goes back to Korea's 20th century history as well as maybe even earlier. And now, given you know, a fresh infusion of force by social media, by digital media, and also by the increasingly, I think, deeply held view that the system's not working quite right. It's beginning to sound kind of familiar. The issue of inequality, of unfair treatment. I mean, one of the things that really seemed to spark the anger at President Park, and again, against the backdrop of a difficult administration at best, but kind of the match that seemed to me to light the fire was when Ewha Women's University students started to protest the fact that Choi Sung-chil's daughter had been admitted preferentially to Ewha University, and moreover, wasn't going to her classes. And that, you know, never happened here, of course. I mean, that outraged Ewha Women's University students, right? I mean, this is a highly competitive society, getting more and more competitive all the time. And what matters more than anything else? Education. Education for your children. So this really seemed to ignite this massive protest that then followed and has now brought us to this point. So, anyway, I'm supposed to talk about foreign relations. That's why I'm not a diplomat anymore. You know, I mean, now all this is happening now here in 2017 when, I mean, guess what? You know, the U.S. had an election, and the outcome here was unexpected, and we are in some new and uncertain ground. Even if sort of things had gone, shall we say, more predictably in the United States, an election year transition in the United States is a time of some anxiety and attention. I don't want to say concern, but attention in the Republic of Korea, because the United States remains, if not still South Korea's largest trading partner, still by far its most important and closest partner, especially concerning the issues of North Korea and all the rest. So normally, South Korea at this time would be working very hard to establish new relationship with the new administration. I should note that President Park Geun-hye, before she was impeached, you know, once she was in, well, before she was voted for impeachment by the National Assembly, and she was still the president, she had a telephone conversation with then-President-elect Trump. She is now, just to clarify, I think you all know this, but she is She has had to recuse herself, a stronger word than that. She's been removed from her duties as president while the court considers the case, and the prime minister, who's a career civil servant, is the acting president. But in any event, she did have one talk with President-elect Trump, which was provided some reassurance, I think, was publicized by the Blue House. And importantly, our new defense secretary, Mr. Mattis, General Mattis, is going to Korea and Japan next week. And I noticed in the Korean press this morning they are making a point of noting that he's going to Korea first, before Japan, and welcoming it as a sign of the importance that that the new administration will attach to the alliance. And of course, this goes in the backdrop. We've had some other sessions about that, some concern about President Trump's approach to alliances overall. But of course, in Korea, it's not just the press, but everyone is pointing at what they would call a political vacuum, feeling very unprepared. Particularly given the number of issues that have been raised in the course of our campaign here in the United States that impact Korea very directly. The new administration, now I'm talking about the U.S. administration attitude towards trade and the aftermath of the withdrawal from the TPP. U.S. is not, South Korea not a signatory to TPP, but of course there's already the Korea-U.S. Free Trade Agreement, which is in many ways the TPP's precursor. So what does all that mean? Will the new, will our new president follow through on his statements about looking closely at the issue of currency manipulation in Northeast Asia, the issue of burden sharing, who pays for what when it comes to our security alliance and our troops in Korea, and of course the issue of the anti-missile program, so-called THAAD, which has been agreed between Seoul and Washington to be deployed to South Korea to partially address the increasing North Korean missile threats. I mention this in particular because actually when you see some of these, having said that a lot of the demonstrations are like festivals, there are signs that will say no THAAD. I just saw a survey actually just done by the Asan Institute very recently showing that the support for THAAD in South Korea, which is fairly high, or deployment of THAAD, there has actually gone down, but attributing it when they ask people not so much to new questions about the necessity of this defense system, but to a sense that with the lack of trust in the government, in this case the South Korean government that reached it, President Park, they think it should be looked at again. So one concrete example of how an issue in which they seem to be moving towards consensus is now perhaps up in the air. And of course, we will see, we know an election this year, and it may come in South Korea, it may come sooner than later. When it comes to China, I think this period of uncertainty in South Korea has created an opening for China to be more aggressive in pressuring Korea, actually still on THAAD, which China has made clear it opposes and considers to be a threat to it, although assurances have been given that it is not. China has done things, I mean, while officially denying it, there seems to be a pretty clear pattern of non-tariff barriers, shall we say, against popular Korean exports to China, such as cosmetics. A crackdown on performances, well, I shouldn't say a crackdown, but a failure to give visas to everything from K-pop stars to the famous South Korean mezzo-soprano, one of my favorites, Sumi Jo, who can't go. So I think this is obviously creating a lot of concern in South Korea. China, of course, is South Korea's business trading partner. Businesses, too, I think feel uncertain, not only in terms of the China relationship, but also because of all the questions of the intersection, the nexus between business and government in Korea that have come forth in this scandal. We can talk more about that. But just one, the giant company Lotte, which of course has important businesses in China, but perhaps also because of uncertainty at home, has slowed down transferring land that would be used for the THAAD deployment to the South Korean government. So I think that sense that Koreans often have anyway of feeling kind of squeezed between the U.S. and China are exacerbated not only by our election here, but most especially by the sense that right now they don't have the leadership at home to handle it. Other examples, and it's not all directly attributable to the crisis in Korea, but I think in some respects influenced by it, efforts to have another trilateral summit that would include Japan, South Korea, and China are kind of off, I think, pretty much indefinitely, let's say. There's worry about a worsening in South Korea-Japan relations. Another example of an agreement reached under the Park Geun-hye government, the agreement on the so-called comfort women issue, wartime legacy issues, seems to be ripe for maybe some reopening with the erection of a statue in Busan across from the Japanese consulate by a South Korean citizens group, and a sense that this may also be, in a way, kind of like Thad, because it was the last government, we need to look at it again. North Korea. Well, you know, North Korea always looks very closely at elections held in the South. It's generally kind of assumed that they'd rather have a progressive win. They certainly have made clear that they're not going to deal anymore with Park Geun-hye. They have explicitly kind of written her off. It's interesting to note that in North Korea, which of course tries to control information coming in very tightly, they have let in some information about the protests and the demonstrations, what's going on in South Korea, presumably to try to indicate, as they've done in past years, it's not new, that there's sort of, you know, South Korea is unstable and there's a lot of, you know, unhappiness and dissatisfaction. But there's also speculation that, you know, they have to be careful about this. I mean, they probably have to, you know, pick their photos, their slices of reality they show very carefully, because it also may show in the North that this kind of protest is possible. It was noted, for example, that Kim Jong-un, in his New Year's address on January 1st, for the first time that we remember, he became the first North Korean leader to express kind of an apology to the North Korean people for failing to meet all of their expectations in terms of economic improvements. Now, you know, what was in his mind when we said that, but interesting to note. This could also obviously affect Kim's calculations on his missile testing, ICBM, and so it always is very hard to say. Also, a very interesting statement that one of my students just shared with me. It has not been translated into English, which I think is interesting. A North Korean statement, a letter of appeal to all Koreans everywhere to work together on unification. So I've been told I'm out of time, so I'll probably stop pretty much here. I want to say one more thing, and that even though this is a very challenging year, a couple of strengths I think Korea really has that we shouldn't forget about. One, it has a strong and professional civil service, and life is going on. And two, I have every confidence that Korea, whenever it holds its election, it will be a free election. There'll probably be a large turnout, in part because digital media is being used so effectively to mobilize people. But it is going to be an election at a time, and we already see this in the beginnings, we haven't talked about the prospective candidates to be the next president, where people are going to be thinking again about, again, some of the questions will be familiar to us as Americans. Are institutions sufficiently responsive? What about the question in South Korea of constitutional revision to address this question of five-year term, lame duck at the end, of such a highly concentrated, highly powerful presidency? You know, what about political parties that seem to come and go with individual candidates and never have any really lasting life? Do they really represent these young people? And again, not so young. There was every age in the streets saying they wanted something different. So a lot to play for this year.
So, thank you. Questions from the floor, please. And if you can, please identify yourself, you know.
Tom Finger, a scholar here at APARC. Thank you all for the presentation. It's a question for any or all of you. What can be said about the specific charges leveled against President Park for impeachment, which to me seem trivial, and general dissatisfaction with the performance of her government? Are the demonstrations really about dissatisfaction with governmental performance, or are they really about the specific acts?
Well, I mean, that's why I mentioned that there are two dimensions, political and legal. So politically, obviously, you know, once again, she lost legitimacy. But that might be different from legal issue, because okay, legally still she has to be proven to be guilty. And then there are a lot of charges against her. And still we have to see, you know, what will be the case, what may not be the case. So, but you know, as you know, the court deliberation will take time, and for the constitutional court, I think they will consider both political and legal issues. So, but I think your question is, you know, it's the kind of question that a lot of, you know, Western, you know, people, you know, asking, whereas in Korea, you know, people just take them as granted. So that's why a lot of people believe that she has to be impeached. Yeah.
So earlier, Professor Shin, you have mentioned the Ewha University as an important piece of the puzzle. I agree with that. I think it's a kind of like chemical compounds. When there are two right compounds, two right chemicals, it can create an explosive. So for example, Koreans care a lot about education, and they invest financial and otherwise resources to send their kids to a decent university. And then they realized this Chungnyura, Choi's daughter, went to Ewha while she was not even one of the stronger candidates, and then her professors wrote the reports for her. So those details justified pressing charges against certain things. And then one of that was the Seoul ferry sinking. And then I think that the decision to include the Seoul ferry and then her Park's response or lack thereof was a kind of political decision, because the entire population watched live while the ferry was sinking, killing 300 people. And then, so there was this legal justification. Park neglected her role as a president to protect the people. But at the same time, this very rare, unusual shared public sentiment warranted the inclusion of that charge. So it's like a chemical compound. That's the image that came to my mind. I'm not sure whether. Yeah,
so. Bob Mart is my name. I'm a retired judge. I have a legal question. I was trying to wrap my head around the Korean constitutional process, whereby you have a constitutional court in Korea. In the United States, an impeachment trial would proceed in the U.S. Senate. Right. And I'm wondering about the makeup of the constitutional court, whether these are judges appointed for life, is this a special tribunal that's convened, and will Park Geun-hye mount, she hasn't mounted a defense in the National Assembly, but she, is it predicted that she will defend herself for the Constitutional Court, or she'll just submit the matter based on whatever evidence is presented? I'd like to get my head around how the process works in Korea.
So,
I can if you want.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, okay. Well, yeah.
You correct me. I'm not
yeah, 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 yeah. Then I let's see. Oh. Add, yeah,
So. Yeah, South Korea has a constitutional court that only hears, you know, constitutional questions. Its Supreme Court is separate. The constitution, which was kind of the democratic constitution, which was accepted in 1987 and has not been amended since, allows for the kind of the articles of impeachment to be brought to the National Assembly. And this has happened once before against Noh Moo-hyun. So they've been through this once, although he in the end was not convicted. I'm not sure if that's the right legal word. But the process is the National Assembly votes on impeachment, on kind of articles of impeachment, then it goes to the Constitutional Court. The Constitutional Court has a maximum of 9 members. Three are appointed by the president, 3 are appointed by the National Assembly, and 3 by somebody else.
The Supreme Court.
Okay. And they have terms. And in this particular instance, one thing that plays into the complicated sort of, yeah, 6-year terms, complicated calendar for this year, is that 2 of the terms of 2 of the judges who have been both appointed by the previous president, Lee Myung-bak, who was conservative, and therefore thought to be perhaps a little more sympathetic to Park Geun-hye, although you can't be sure, that their terms are expiring in, I think, this month and March, respectively. So, in fact, the judge just the other day announced that he hoped that there would be a decision. They would try to make a decision by March. They have up to 6 months to make a decision. Once they make a decision, then a presidential election must be held within 60 days. What were your other questions?
Yeah, so I think the chief judge or the chair, I think his term already expired. Mm-hmm. So right now, 8 people, and as Kathy mentioned, I think the other one, her term expires March 13. Mm-hmm. So if they don't make decision by then, and if they don't refill the members, then there will be only seven people who will be making a judgment. So it's a little tricky part because I think overall composition of the judges are fairly conservative because last administration was also conservative. Okay, but at the same time, this popular demand for impeachment was so strong. Okay, so that's why a lot of people believe that, you know, she will be no doubt impeached. And but in my view, I say again, it's very likely, but I don't think it's over. And you know, Madam Park has not conceded; she's fighting. I think she'll fight to the end, and then we'll see the outcome. So, you know, once again, very likely that it's going to happen. If not, then it's a big turmoil. Yeah.
Yeah, to date she has refused to appear before the court, but she has now gone to the press in some small ways. There's also some speculation that if it looks like that the court might actually remove her, that she might just before that resign, because if she does that, she would retain certain post office benefits. Anyway, so there's various scenarios.
My name is Ara Cho. I'm from Korea, and I'm currently in the law school attending LLM program for a year. I'm a Korean attorney. And I have been practicing for 5 years. And just checked the website to make sure that I was right. And before making my question, just to address the prior question, so it's the Constitutional Court is a permanent institution which deals with constitutional issues, and the hearing itself is an adversarial procedure, so each party, like president on one side and the Congress on the other side, will present their arguments, and they will have the hearings. So that's the kind of process that the court will pursue. And my question is, I was a little bit late, so my apologies if it was addressed already during the speeches, but I saw a recent survey that asking people what was the most important value that you will want to see from the next president. And interestingly, the justice came as the first one. It's sure. Kind of struck me very interesting because for our recent, past several years, economic development has been kind of people's prior minds. So, whatever the candidates say, people's attention comes to the question, so how are you going to revive the economics? And so how are you going to make our lives better in terms of economic development? So that struck me very interesting, and whether you saw that survey or not, how you see this incident hopefully positively affect the future political sentiment in the future. Yeah.
I think I saw the results. And then along with that, the justice was the first value that they want to see in the next president in the election. One thing that caught my attention was that national security was the fourth one. Typically, it's one of the top two or three. And that's why I think that maybe we are seeing some very subtle but somewhat substantial transition in political culture, because in the past elections, both general and presidential, typically we could expect very clear stance toward certain stuff, like North Korea, US, or some of the economic kind of policies. But it seems that, and along with that, according to one survey in November, 40% of the population identified themselves as a progressive. I can't believe that, but I think that was the sentiment at the time. So I think that this might be a moment where this existing political bipartisan political culture with a strong fault line might get confused or shifting a little. So I think in that sense, it's something hopeful coming out of this period of crisis. Yeah.
Also, I think, as you mentioned earlier, you know, looking back, actually, this whole process was triggered by this scandal at Ewha Women's University. Mm-hmm. So that once again, it's a very prestigious college, and then it's very hard to get in. And then when they found that this Jung Yura got into university, a lot of people thought it's very unfair, and so that really triggered this whole process. So as you know. There's a book written by the Harvard professor, Michael Sander, I think, What is Justice? Mm-hmm. So Korean translation sold more than 1 million copies in Korea. So in Korea, any book that sells more than a million, it's almost like selling 100 million copies in the United States. So I don't know whether you read the book. It's not really entertaining book, but still sold more than 1 million. That means that Koreans are really now care about social justice. So,
Uni Valentine, the recent article from FSI questioned. It was entitled "The Rule of Man or the Rule of Law," and it was in the context of the U.S. Elections, I think. And I understand that Korea is a very young democracy. But it seems to me that and here it would be the rule of lots of men, not a single person, obviously, but if the rule of law is not enforced and respected, it really is taking Korean democracy a big step back, right? To allow the popular voice to do something as impeach a president is one thing, to establish protests, to say we don't like, we believe something is unjust, we want to have a change. But to go against the rule of law to achieve that seems to me as both as once a legal scholar and an observer, just such a backward step in the democratic development of the country. And in this context, maybe you can help answer the question. I was just curious whether the Constitutional Court, if they go with the political winds, and even though there is no legal basis for impeachment, concede to proceed with an impeachment, is that like the Supreme Court? Do they have the ability to make law? Does that set a precedent for future presidents that can be impeached on a national whim? Or is there no legal precedent that's set by the Constitutional Court the way there is in the United States, by the Supreme Court? So the Supreme Court in the U.S. can make law, right? If they issue a ruling that doesn't have precedence. So I'm just curious whether this would set a precedent for future presidents also, if they do go with the political winds.
Okay, let me clarify one thing and then answer your question. One is, okay, so far Korea has been following the law. Okay, because at one point, a lot of people were demanding her step down, resign. Okay, but then now a lot of people saying that let's follow the law. I mean, that's why going through assembly, then now deliberation on the Constitutional Court, that's a rule. So far, Korea has been following the rule. Okay, now regarding judgment at the Constitutional Court, in my understanding, okay, so I'm not a legal expert. Once again, the main thing is that whether she has made a grave violation of constitutional law. I mean, that's a main criteria. And I don't think that's strictly legal issue. I think it's both a legal and political issue. So I think the court will decide based on both political and legal issue. That's my understanding. I mean, that's why this is different from Supreme Court.
If it's a grave, violation of constitutional law. Yeah. It's a law that she has to violate it. I don't understand how the political perspective can be brought into that, because the Constitution is a written Constitution.
Right, but then how to interpret that is open to debate. In other words, whether Madam Park has violated Constitution or not, okay? And I think it's a fairly open question in my view. So In making that decision, I think they will consider political factors as well. That's my understanding of this process. So, but then I think the real question is, you know, let's say if the court said no, right? Okay, then whether people will honor that the decision and then have an election in December, or they will demand something else. I mean, then I think the Korean democracy will be on test. But until now, in my view, they have followed the procedure. So,
I mean, just one other data point, rather than, and that is, there was an arrest, I guess, warrant requested. I may not have the legal words right, by the prosecutors for the chairman or the acting chairman of Samsung, mm-hmm. And the court found that not to be, I guess, justified.
Yeah.
And so he warranted. So he wasn't arrested. But I think this is a period of considerable crisis and questioning for the legal system in Korea. I'm not making a comment about, you know, I don't know anything about the merits of the request. But the other area where Korean, you know, legal system has, I think, been pretty challenged is in dealing with is in the relationship between business and government, and actually business and law. You know, we have many of, especially the big businesses, where they've been convicted of fairly serious offenses, and then they're not served a time, not been punished or been pardoned because of their importance to the national economy. So, this is a pretty big moment. I think you make that point for Korea's institutions and where they're going to go.
My name is Esther Chang. I'm the resident here, Bay Area. My question for all of you is, the social media played a great role for a gathering of all these people. And my question for all of you, what is your opinion about the validation of information that was shared on the social media? And I mean, it brought up to this situation, but how can we control it? I mean, what if we're moved by some information that's not right, validated? I mean, that's a big, I don't know how, so that is my question for all of you.
I mean, is there fake news in Korea?
So, as someone who studies internet and then social movements, I have that question and dilemma, because sometimes I see social media serving certain kind of purposes and on the side of like justice, but at the same time, it becomes a font for this false information. And then I think that the buyer captures it. You cannot really control it. But at the same time, instead of just having this black box approach, you don't know how the information spreads, and it spread like germs. But I also think that when information spreads, even though the most undesirable kind of information spread, I think that there could be certain kind of cultural reasons. For example, when there are a lot of conjectures and then conspiracy theories circulating about the whereabouts of Park for the first 7 hours, and typically conspiracy theories circulate when people care about an issue at hand, but institutional politics fail to give on like sufficient information. And that's when people start sharing conjectures, conspiracy theories, and rumors. So I think that there could be a certain level of explanation and potential response to that, but not comprehensive approach to that. So that's my somewhat.
So my comments on Korean media, as you know, we have journalists here, but we have a lot of problems with the Korean media. So in the past, I only believe at most 50% of what they're saying in the media. But I think people are saying that this time media played a very important role. Okay, so initially, the prosecutor's office was very hesitant to investigate some allegations. But I think this time media went all the way to find every fact and detail. So in a sense, putting a lot of pressure on the prosecutor's office to investigate. So some people who I met in Korea are joking that it's the first time the Korean media really fulfilled its mission. But still, I think there are some exaggeration and some misrepresentation. But I mean, that's true in all the media. I mean, in the United States, we're not completely free either. So.
My name is David Chang. the question regarding transparency of government, because, you know, a lot of accusation, a lot of scandal comes out so late. I mean, Park Geun-hye has been public figure for many years, but how come we didn't know about anything like that? And then my question is to you, to the panel, is, you know, government transparency, who's responsible for that? Is it media, public, or is it government administration? I'd like to ask the panel for that.
I think I'd go back mostly to media. When it comes to the case of President Park, you say, you know, people didn't know. I think people knew quite a bit about her. Certainly her association with the father of Ms. Che was known, for example. It was not heavily and repeatedly reported by the press, because I think the press was somewhat constrained and maybe self-constrained in how it reported things. So I'm not sure the issue was really transparency in terms of, her past. And in terms of her time in office, and some of the things that she's accused of doing, I have a little trouble because they wouldn't, I think they do show a certain institutional weakness in some of the relationships, maybe between business and government. I guess I keep going back to that, because to me, one of the more serious charges, unproven, but that money was extorted, right? So there's a weakness there, and there's a weakness around transparency there. But in terms of her own life and her own associations, I think it was something that didn't really come to the fore because people didn't see very much there. But
I think one factor in my view is that, you know, Korean politics and also Korean media are so divided ideologically. So if progressive media, report those things, and then the other side is saying that that's allegation based on political and ideological interests. Okay, so that one party making certain claims and the other saying that's a false accusation. So I think that also adds up more confusion, and then people only believe in certain part of the story. So that's, I think, one maybe an extra factor in my view.
I think I have to make a statement a little bit on this, because the operation of Blue House in this administration was very opaque, more than before. That was a problem, I think. And we need to really see the prosecution, the killers, the final results. But I think that whenever this lady, Madame Che, was exposed to the other ministers or public, then president was not very frank and honest about that. So I'm also very disappointed that President Park does not very actively cooperate with the investigation, and very politically kind of respond to that. That's not good for the nation. And for the lady on this North Korean issue, and in fact, I'm studying this, and this national security issue and the northern refugees is very fundamental in our South Korea's conservatism. But at the same time, I think this is now the point that South Korean conservatism have to move on to a different level. So with this firm stand, kind of position on national security, at the same time, very transparent and democratic and legal institution, we really need this at this point. So like this impeachment process will move toward a very promising conclusion. I hope, really hope at this point. Yes, we have one more question.
Yeah. So Professor Shin's comment that 20 years ago this type of thing wouldn't have happened, I wanted to ask a question about the question of gender. You know, how, to what extent do you sense Professor Park's being the first female president, how that has played, or if people have been deliberately avoiding the subject of gender, or if there's some misogyny under, you know, underground, or what your thoughts are on this.
I think that's an important but tough question, because I think some people are also saying that because she's a woman, right? This is happening. So what if she was a man? Would it be happening at the same way? And I think it's open question, and you may have a better answer than I do. So, but that's a good question to, I think, to reflect for all of us, because still Korea is very male-dominant society, and in many ways she became a leader because of her father's legacy, right? So she's not ordinary woman in Korea, right, in Korean politics. So I think gender is very, I think, complicated issue in this in a situation. So you are raising good question, but I don't have any clear answer.
Hi, I'm Sang Jun. I'm a graduate student in sociology here at Stanford. I just wanted to share my experience organizing a student movement here about the issue with Korean students. So, well, it's not really a question, but as one of the youth generation covered in the presentation, I just wanted to share. So Dr. Shin mentioned that there was a big candlelight rally movement on November 12th. Well, on November 11th, a group of Stanford undergrad and grad students here on campus get together at the White Plaza on campus, and we read our statement about the issue. And well, as you know, usually on campus dormitories or, you know, in campus social gatherings, there are two things that you don't want to talk about. One is religion and the other one is politics. But this event, well, we're actually very thankful to President Park for actually letting us to open this discussion about democracy and politics. And that's what we said actually at the event, because we usually don't talk about politics because, you know, there could be conservatives, there could be progressives, there could be some middle ground people. But due to this event, we actually began to talk about, you know, the issue of democracy and justice and social justice. And before this event, I was, well, not politically apathetic, but didn't pay much attention to Korean politics. But throughout the unfolding of this event and all the issues around this, I guess it was a lot of, this event was like a moment of political awakening for a lot of Koreans abroad also, especially among the young generation. So I also wanted to share that story with you. And about the issue of social media, I think there is a lot of danger with the spread of, you know, unconfirmed information, but at the same time, there are a lot of citizens who try to come up with, you know, valid information among themselves, try to, you know, retort back, okay, this is not true, let's not spread it. So there's this sense of community that tries to sort of cultivate, you know, correct information, and okay, we should not do this, we should go in the right direction. So I think, I mean, the challenge of democracy is that it's open to pitfalls, but at the same time, people can get together and talk about, okay, where's the right direction we have to go? And I think, so in that sense, I think it's rather wise not to shut it down, but open it to, you know, open discussions and for more direct democracy in our generation. So that's my thought on the issue.
If I could just chime in on that hopeful, maybe that's a nice hopeful way to kind of close. I think there's room for, as we've heard here, I mean, some, you know, concern and difference of views about how this particular process has gone or will go. But one thing that I find encouraging is I also, in November, I would ask, I saw a lot of university students, and they were all going out to the protests. And they all said to me, most of them said, well, I wasn't alive in 1987, and but now this is my generation's moment. You know, I have a responsibility. And actually, as you talk to them individually, it wasn't clear whether they were, you know, progressive or conservative or, you know, how they might vote in the next election. But it certainly has politically, you know, galvanized people to think that they have a role to play. So I think the challenge for, if you like, the institutions and the system and the politicians is, you know, how to harness that and how to make the kind of, clearly the reforms that need to be made. That's another thing everybody agrees on, but that's not to say they're going to all agree on how to do it.
Okay.
Thank you very much for coming, and please give a hand to our panelists and moderators.